Okay, now coming to unit 3, which consists of lipids, that is fats. So first we'll do the classification. Now classifications can be simple lipids, compound lipids and derived lipids. What are simple lipids? Simple lipids are maybe lipids, fatty acids with one other component, that is glycerol plus fatty acid, or long chain alcohol plus long chain fatty acids. These are the common descriptions. If we come to the subclasses, wacks, what we call as wacks. Wacks are normally long chain alcohol and long chain fatty acids, and acyl glycerols are glycerol and fatty acids. The next type is compound lipids. The first subclass is phosphoacyl glycerol, or glycerol plus fatty acid plus a phosphate group and another group usually containing nitrogen. The second subclass is sphingomyelines, which is sphingosine, fatty acid, phosphate and choline. The third subclass is cereblosides, which is basically sphingosine, fatty acid and simple sugar. The next part, next subclass is gangliosides, which is sphingosines, fatty acid, complex carbohydrate that includes sialic acid. Okay. And the third type is derived lipids. Materials that meet the definition of lipid but are not simple or compound, basically which are not coming under the first and the second type, is basically derived lipids. The examples are fatty acid, carotenoids, steroids, fat soluble vitamins, these. Now there are two types of fats and oils. One is fatty acids, that's saturated fatty acids and unsaturated fatty acids. Okay. In our customary to divide the fatty acids into different groups, saturated and unsaturated ones. Saturated means they have many hydrogen bonded to their carbons as possible. And unsaturated meaning with one or more double bonds connecting their carbons, hence fewer hydrogens. So you get the difference. One contains more number of hydrogen and one has double bonds but lesser amount of hydrogen into it. There is certain other thing, there are certain other classifications of fats which we traditionally maintain. As the name suggests, the division goes like this. There are milk fats. Basically, milk fats are the fats coming from milk or the casein part, lactose part maybe. Lauric fats, which is basically from palm. The palm oil comes under lauric fats. Vegetable butters, that is vanaspati, which we normally refer as vanaspati in our nutritive value count. Oleic acid and linoleic acid, or these type of fats, which comes from sunflower, safflower, sesame oils, these type of things. Linoleic acid, which comes from mustard, soya bean, rape seed, flaxseed, that is from oil seeds. And animal fats, that comes from mutton or maybe some kinds of fish with thicker fat layer. And marine oils. Basically, animal fats are divided into the marine fat and the ones from the animals which stays in the land. So, if we divide it, some comes from the chicken or mutton and some from the marine fishes. Now coming to the functional properties. Basically there are unsaturated fatty acid and polyunsaturated fatty acids, which we commonly see in oil commercial advertisements. They say that MUFA or TUFA, that is monounsaturated fatty acids or polyunsaturated fatty acids, and other than that saturated fatty acids is the type. So prevalent saturated fatty acids are lauric acid, myristic acid, palmitic acid, stearic acid, and monounsaturated fatty acids example may be oleic acid and erucic acid, and polyunsaturated fatty acid examples may be linoleic acid and linoleic acid. Don't be confused, because there are two types of things. One is linoleic and one is linolenic. N comes in between. The only difference is in this, in linoleic acid with the end missing in it, the carbon portion is 18:2, and on the other one, the carbon portion is 18:3. Now coming to the usage of functionality, one more functionality is frying. Lipids, whenever we think of any type of fat or oil, frying comes in first. So what are the factors, or maybe how does that include in this frying method? First of all, heat frying, where the temperature is the main thing. It might be in high temperature, it might be in low temperature sauteing. Now comes air. So normally while we are frying certain things, oxygen plays a major role. The amount of oxygen changes the procedure and the product. Moisture. When something, whichever we are frying, is a moist food which contains water, the water content in which food is higher, in that case what happens, the hydrolysis of fats and the oils differ from the ones with lower moisture content. One more thing is the contamination of oil is a contaminant. Oil comes in, oil has a functionality of a contaminant. As we know, oil and water doesn't mix up, but we can differentiate when there is oil bubbles in water, and that is a contaminant. Normally there are in soaps or some types of detergent, oils are present, and that is a, that might be used purposely, or that can be contaminant or an adulterant into it. Now coming to auto oxidation of fat, of course. So there is three processes which includes inside auto oxidation. The first one is initiation. In the initiation part, the hydrogen is removed from the fatty acid chain to yield a free radical. And now what is free radical? Free radical, we will explain you about everything in biochemistry. Now, the removal of this hydrogen from the fatty acid chain takes place at a carbon atom next to the double bond, and can be brought about by action of light, metals, etc. Now the second portion, now once this free radical is formed, it will combine with oxygen to form a peroxy free radical, which can remove hydrogen from another unsaturated molecule who yield a peroxide and a new free radical. This entire process is called propagation reaction. The propagation can be followed by termination if the free radical react with themselves to yield non-active products. This is called termination. That means the entire auto-oxidation process is coming to an end. There is a diagrammatic representation in page number 85 of your food science book. So you can go through it, and this thing is explained in a diagrammatic manner so that it will be easier for you to understand. Now there are certain factors which normally affect the lipid oxidation, that can be fatty acid composition, oxygen concentration, temperature, surface area in which this thing is happening, moisture, and pro-oxidants. One more thing we come to is lipolysis. What is lipolysis? Hydrolysis of ester bonds in the lipids are called lipolysis. As the name suggests, lipolysis, if we break down, lipid breakdown is known as lipolysis, as lysis means breakdown. Now coming to thermal decomposition. So while we go through the thermal decomposition of fats and oils, from fats and oils it is broken down into saturated and unsaturated fatty acids. Now the saturated portion with thermolytic reaction becomes acid hydrocarbons, propanol and acrolein ketones. And thermolytic reactions, the O2 part goes to the long chain alkaline aldehyde, ketone and lactones. In case of unsaturated fatty acids, the thermolytic reactions, the products from the thermolytic reactions are acyclic and cyclic dimers. This is a very common thing in this COVID scenario. We do a test named as D-dimer test, and which suggests us the amount of coagulation or the amount of thickening of blood which has happened due to COVID reaction. So basically this entire process is an example that I am giving you. This entire process happens due to the unsaturated fatty acids present in our blood. And for that we can determine the cyclic dimers present, and that way we can determine how far has the infection reduced or how far has the infection caused damage inside our lungs. This is just an example in this present scenario. Okay, the O2 from the unsaturated fatty acids are volatile and dimeric products of auto-oxidation. Okay. There is also an antioxidant like effect of lipids. Like I told in the previous chapter, all types of nutrients have some less and more kind of an antioxidant effect. And the characteristics are tocopherols. Normally primary antioxidants are tocopherols. Butylated hydroxyanisole, that is BHA, which we normally know as tertiary butyl hydroquinone, that is TBHQ. So that means we come to an end of unit 3, and again the same thing which I'll be repeating is, if you face any doubt, I know this is very difficult because I would be needing a blackboard to explain all these types, because food chemistry is nothing to be done via video. I know you will be facing certain doubts and you need to be addressed with that. Please come to us in this WhatsApp group with all your doubts. Thank you.